everyone. Apologies for the technical difficulties we were having. That's why we're a little bit late today. So glad you could join us. If the picture is not quite as clear as in the past, it's because we had to make some adjustments to our tech today. But hopefully you can hear us clearly and you can see us, and we're really hoping we can answer some time-sensitive questions around the admissions cycle. So just to introduce myself, my name is Jessie Metcalf, and I have recently returned to my role as Associate Registrar Enrollment Management here in the Faculty of Medicine. And with me is...
My name is Alex, and I'm the Student Enrollment Services Assistant, and I'm here also to answer questions for the this upcoming application cycle.
Great. So you've definitely met Alex before, and I've been on these Facebook Lives a while back as well. What we're planning to do today is go through some of the common questions we're getting via phone and email, and from there we will open it up to your questions as well. So we'll plan to spend about a half an hour today. We understand we might get questions about all facets of the admissions process, but we are really hoping to address the more time-sensitive questions that we're getting right now also, because we know that the deadline is coming up in a couple of weeks. So we want to make sure that, you know, we're getting through our FAQs.
All right, so I guess without further ado, let's actually start on the questions. So we have received a few questions that are quite common starting with the cycle. So we're going to sort of go through them first, and then we'll open for more questions at the end. So one of the most common questions we have first is about the word limit. On OMSAS, there is a 2,000 character word limit, but on our website, we do state that it is a word limit of 250. So do we abide to the word limit or to OMSAS's character limit? So please follow our instructions based on the word limit, okay? It is there to ensure that you are able to showcase and demonstrate all of your skills and your experiences within that word limit. So it's meant to be used as a guideline, all right?
Great. So another common question we are getting is around the OMSAS referee requirement. So you'll know if you're applying to any of the Ontario medical schools, you're applying through OMSAS, and there is one common referee requirement listed on OMSAS. So essentially, we're looking for three references, and the way OMSAS has worded it is it's one academic, one employment or extracurricular, and one personal. So we're getting some questions around, specifically around the mention of a personal reference. Now, I want to make clear that we are really looking for three references of your choosing. Definitely one of those references should be academic. One should be related to your non-academic, so that could be workplace, volunteer, extracurricular, and so on. And that third reference, which OMSAS mentions as personal, is really up to you to decide who you want to use. So it could be another academic reference, it could be another non-academic reference. But I think the main point we want to make when it comes to referees is these should be people that know you quite well in terms of being able to speak to your abilities, your achievements and characteristics. It should, however, not be someone that is close to you in terms of a family connection, relative, neighbor, peer, friend, anything like that would not be deemed acceptable for a referee. So the language around personal, I think we get some confusion over. It doesn't mean someone that you know personally in a friendship capacity. It's more someone that can speak to your personal characteristics.
Right. Yeah. So I know on OMSAS they do say that it's a personal referee, but by no means does that mean it's someone that you know personally, like a friend or a peer. So basically, treat it as a character reference, someone who knows your character traits, your values, and also obviously based on our professors.
That's a great point. So you think about how your three referees should be able to cover off all four of those clusters.
On to our next question that's also very common. Do my referees need to submit an additional reference letter? Now, first thing is I do want to differentiate between the MD application and the MD PhD. So unless you are applying for the MD PhD, meaning if you're only applying to the MD program, your referees do not need to submit an additional letter. They are only submitting references directly through OMSAS, through the confidential assessment form, which is also called a CAF. But if you are applying for the MD PhD, then you also need three additional reference letters in addition to your three references. So your referees can also submit a reference letter for you, but that's only for the MD PhD.
So another common question we're getting is related to how to find all these materials that we refer to in your OMSAS application. So sometimes we'll have students that will message and say, where do I input my information on brief personal essays? Where do I input my ABS information? So you'll notice when you go into your OMSAS application and you select your school submissions, under the school submissions section, when you select U of T, it will actually populate with all of the things that you're required to complete as part of our application. So your brief personal essay questions, all four of them will pop up there and you'll be able to click into them and enter your responses. Same thing for autobiographical statements will pop up there as well. The academic explanation essay, if you're using it, is available there. And then, of course, your referee information is actually on another tab because the referee information is something that's shared across the university application, so across the Ontario Med Schools. So it should be pretty clear to find once you log into your OMSAS account and go to the school submissions page. Once you click through to U of T, all of that information is there for you. And that's also, when we talk about references, another thing that pops up is the graduate verifier. So the graduate verifier is a new requirement that we have this year. As you'll know probably from watching previous videos and seeing the updates on our website, we've done away with the graduate reference letter. So instead we are requiring that students provide a graduate verifier. This can be your graduate supervisor, it can be someone from your graduate program office, like your course director or coordinator. It really is just a name and a contact information so that we can get in touch with that person if we need to verify anything about your degree, when it was completed, when it's going to be completed, etc. So that section, that graduate verifier piece, is actually found under the referees section. So when you go into the referee section, you'll be able to again select a drop down from what you're trying to fill out, whether it's 1, 2, or 3 referees, MD, PhD referees, or your graduate verifier.
Mm-hmm. So on to our next question. Do my exchange courses count towards my GPA? So a lot of you probably are doing exchange programs either for a semester or throughout the summer and outside of Canada or the US. So you do not need to submit, first of all, a WES report, okay? And exchange courses do not count towards your GPA. They, however, need to appear on your home university transcript, and typically they will not have a mark, and that's okay, because they don't count towards your GPA, but it will show whether you have received a credit or not. So they will appear on your home university transcript as a transfer credit, and you do not need to submit a WES report. However, if they do not appear on your home university transcript, then please contact us either through phone or by email, and we'll have to get a little bit more information from you and see whether that'll be necessary or not. Mm-hmm.
So it's always, when in doubt, it's always a good idea to follow up if you're not sure if your transcripts appear or your marks appear, your course transfers appear on your transcripts, then follow up with your home institution to make sure that's the case and get in touch with us if you're unclear about that. Okay, so will it affect my application if I do not take all my courses at the same level in the same corresponding year? So this comes up as well, and I'm going to try to speak up a little bit because I understand that the sound is not great on the device we're using right now. We had to go a bit low tech for this session to get up on time. So in terms of taking courses that correspond with your year of study, this is not a firm requirement in any way. It's not formally assessed in our office. Essentially, we want to see that you're progressing through your degree program, so that's why it's recommended that, you know, you're taking courses that correspond to your level of study. But in no way are we making an assessment, a formal assessment around, you know, that all your fourth year, in your fourth year, all your classes are expected to be fourth year level courses, for instance. So it's not a formal requirement.
Right, so now changing gears a little bit for the MD PhD as well, we have questions about, you know, how to apply for the program. Specifically, do I need to submit an additional reference letter? And what format are these letters and how should I send them? So if you're applying to the MD PhD program, you do require 3 additional reference letters. So that's in addition to your 3 references, your confidential assessment form. And typically what happens is is you'll be putting your referees, similar to your references, on OMSAS, and then they will send them a link to actually complete the reference letter directly by submission through OMSAS. Okay? So basically, the format is a narrative reference letter, and your referee will submit them directly themselves, because it is confidential in nature, directly to OMSAS.
Great. And so the last question that we've pulled from our most common questions of the moment is around MCAT. So we understand that a lot of MCAT scores are being released this month for students that have written the test in the summer. And the questions are around what happens if I only receive, 123 in one of the sections, or if my score should fall slightly below our MCAT requirement. Now for us, our requirement is quite strict. So we've changed it this year to allow for a bit more leniency. The requirement is that you have 125 in each of the four sections, but we now have an allowance for one section to fall to 124. Now, if you fall below that, we really are firm. So the way we use MCAT in our admissions process is it's really like a threshold or a flag. And if you achieve the requirement that we've set, you get a checkbox and your application kind of moves forward in the process. If you do not, then your application will not move forward. So I do want to be quite upfront about that applying with a score lower than our minimum would mean that your application would not move forward. Now, the only exceptions really to this would be if we had a student who encountered a technical issue or something happened during the actual test itself. In that case, we always require that the student would then approach the MCAT testing center, get a letter to verify what the issue was, and then forward that to us for consideration with their application. So that would really be the only exception we'd be looking to make for MCAT. It is quite a firm minimum we have stated.
So this is sort of a snapshot of all of the common questions we receive at the beginning of the cycle. If you have any more questions, feel free to watch this video again, send us an email, or give us a call. We're now going to open up to any more questions you might have for the next couple of minutes. And already I see a question that's very common as well that we receive. So the applicant is asking, if our supervisor is a referee, should we enter them twice? Once has a normal referee and once has a graduate verifier. So please, yes. So it's two separate processes. So you should enter them on the referee section, whereby OMSAS will send them a link for the confidential assessment form, but also put them on the referee section where it will say Toronto graduate verifier, because that is a separate procedure whereby at the discretion of the admissions team, they will contact your supervisor solely to just confirm, what type of graduate degree are you in, are you in progress of completing it, and so forth.
I don't see any other questions coming through at the moment, but we'll give it a few more minutes. I do actually have a couple of reminders that just came to mind to share. So on the OMSAS website, it does say that you should make sure to trigger your referee email by September 15th. So this is coming up, so that's a good reminder to students that if you have not already entered your referee information, you should take the time to do that very soon so that the email with the reference request will be sent to your referee and it will give them some time to actually complete the reference. And again, these aren't narrative letters this year. Alex kind of alluded to this earlier. It is a form that they are being asked to fill out. So we hope that it's a little bit more clear and straightforward for referees to do. But definitely make sure that you're submitting their information soon so that you give them, an appropriate amount of turnaround time. And it really is your duty as the applicant to our program to check in with your referees and remind them that October 1st is our final deadline. So don't leave it to chance and hope that your referee will, submit on time. Make sure when you've asked them to be a referee that you're clear on the deadline and make sure you're following up to ensure that they have actually submitted that prior to or on the October 1st deadline.
Just talk a little bit more about the confidential assessment forms, the CAFs. We received increase about Sometimes there might be issues that have come up after a referee has submitted the form, or they might have used the wrong name, or questions about the form itself. So these questions need to be directed to OMSAS. They do have instructions now on the website, which might be a little bit hard to locate sometimes, but basically if there's any issues with the confidential assessment forms or the submission of these forms, please actually send OMSAS a message via the SAM tool. So those are the actual instructions on the OMSAS guideline. Any issues with regards to referees receiving the form or having put information that they would like to change, you have to contact OMSAS through SAM.
And I do also want to mention that contacting OMSAS absolutely for certain issues is very important. But likewise, we assume that most applicants are applying to multiple medical schools in Ontario when they're submitting their OMSAS application. So the information we are providing is relevant to our process here at U of T. But if you have questions around, for instance, the WES assessment on exchange credit, or MCAT cutoffs or requirements, those will be different from school to school. So it's always a good idea to check in with each of the medical schools you're applying to make sure that you've covered off, the required process for each of us. Another question? Okay, so the question is, hello, just asking clearly, is U of T accepting international students for the Faculty of Medicine, please confirm? And the answer is yes, we do accept international students into our program. So we do have a supernumerary, so additional seats outside of the 259 seats we have for Canadian applicants for international applicants as well. So it's the same application process through OMSAS, same requirements. If you've done education outside of Canada or the US, then we would need a WES assessment alongside your transcript so that we could see how your previous studies relates or is equivalent to a Canadian degree. So that would be something to consider. But absolutely, other than that, the process really is quite straightforward. It's the same process that all of our applicants use. And if you are an international student and you are coming from a different country and have some questions about how education gets assessed and things like that, feel free to get in touch with us, because we know that it can take a few extra steps in terms of getting that WES assessment.
I'm just going to piggyback that on that a little bit. I do receive a lot of questions with regards to whether we need an English language proficiency test, or whether they need to prove that they have satisfied these requirements. So basically, we don't have any English language proficiency requirements, meaning you do not have to take a test. Mm-hmm. And primarily because when you write the MCAT, that is basically tested on the MCAT. The MCAT is written in English, so if you have passed and met our MCAT threshold scores, then we assume that you'll be proficient and able to continue moving forward onto our application cycle.
Yeah, that's a good point to mention. And also we do get a lot of inquiries from international students who are just starting out their journey and looking to apply for medicine here at U of T or in Canada. And a pretty big distinction is that medical school here in Canada is a second entry program. So students can't go from high school right into medicine here. Canadian candidates will know this well, but if you're coming from another country, many of the medical programs around the world are entered right following high school. So for us, we do require some university study equivalent to a 4-year Canadian bachelor's degree before you would be eligible to come into the program. We have a question here. I don't know if it's got all the information we need. Did we miss any part of that?
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah. The question is, further, would it prevent the application from going into full review? So I'm not sure if this is related to the MCAT discussion we had earlier or another piece of information. If it's related to MCAT and the scores were below our requirements, then yes, it would prevent your application from going into further review. So that is an important distinction. Some medical schools actually use MCAT alongside GPA, or they look at it sort of in a different way than we do. We really use it as a firm cutoff. So if you don't have that, sort of, I call it a checkbox, just because if you don't, you know, meet that requirement, then the rest of your application wouldn't go into further review. If that wasn't the correct answer, though, whoever asked the question, Abby, you can please elaborate, and we'll respond. Any other good reminders right now that we can think of? Oh, another question.
So here's a good question. Would I be able to verify self-directed computer programming work by uploading a link to, let's say, to a specific web page or so forth? Also talk about the second part of the question from Abby. So in terms of, I guess I can speak more broadly, in terms of activities that, you know, are self-directed or in due to sort of personal circumstances that you might not be able to find a verifier, it is also acceptable to use a peer, a friend, or even a family member. Or sometimes, for example, if like, you have a self-directed project, you can write on the verifier that, you know, it's self-directed or, you know, preferably if you have someone who can actually vouch for it, let's say a family member or someone who has seen you engage in that activity, it's perfectly acceptable. We understand that, you know, there are circumstances where, for example, if you have started your own business or an initiative with a family member, that there might not be anybody else except for the family member to verify and to vouch for that activity. In that case, that is totally okay.
And I think the real distinction there is that a verifier is not providing a reference in any way. Like, the verifier is simply verifying that the activity happened, or, you know, that you are involved in this specific thing. So we're not asking for any reference information, which is why it's okay that it's someone that might be related to, for instance. I'll address Abby's second part of the question is around prerequisite courses. So we would not contact applicants after they submit their application if a prerequisite was missing, for instance. We don't go in and make pull out information like that and follow up with applicants. We expect when you submit your application that it is complete. And if you are missing a prerequisite, again, that would take you out of the assessment process. So if you are concerned around prerequisites, and this is very common, we are getting lots of questions around this, you can check your course with our office by providing us with the institution name, the course code and title, and the brief description from your school's website, and we can double check that for you. I will say we're getting a lot of prerequisite questions at the moment, so please bear in mind it might take a few days, like I'd say maybe up to 4 days or so, for us to respond to prerequisite related questions. So if this is something you're concerned about, ask soon so that we can get a response to you, you know, before the application deadline comes up.
I'm going to answer both Helen and Effie's questions because they do seem to be somewhat related. So questions regarding, you know, are there specific courses that we are required to take or programs that would probably give me an advantage in applying to our MD program? So you are able to take basically any program and any courses in any discipline, provided that it's not medicine, because we don't have a preference. So you're able to take, you know, engineering, economics, life sciences, health sciences, and so forth. Now do be aware that we do have our required prerequisite courses that you need to take throughout your undergraduate degree, but this is simply a completion of these courses. So two full course equivalents, or basically four semester courses in any life sciences, and also one full course equivalent, or two semester courses in a social science or humanities or in a language course, and you can combine them. Essentially, this will be at your discretion, right? It's based purely based on, we usually advise students to go for a program that you're passionate about, that you're interested in, because typically we find students do much better when they're actually interested in the course and in the program.
Yeah. Good advice.
We also have a question from Dijet. My apologies if I mispronounced your name. Should we include hobbies or other personal activities on the ABS, or just official activities like clubs, research, etc.? Once again, the way that the ABS works is it's meant to provide a list of your experiences that you think as an applicant can demonstrate the four clusters of attributes. So once again, we don't have any preferences for medical experience or for any sort of specific club activities and so forth. So you're able to include anything that you think is able to demonstrate your message, and also include on your personal narrative an
keeping in mind, you know, you only have so many entries to fill out on your ABS, so you do need to be a little bit critical. And I always advise students it's a good idea to kind of make a big long list of all the things that you feel kind of make you who you are, your accomplishments and things that you've been a part of, and then really go through those four clusters and try to pull out ones that you think would really highlight those four clusters. So you're going to have to be a bit selective, likely, in what you include there, but absolutely, you know, if there's hobbies or extracurricular things that you're really passionate about, that probably is you know, a big part of your life and makes you who you are in some way. So it's never something that, you know, you should kind of disregard because it's not medically related or it doesn't show a specific level of experience in healthcare. We have many students that talk about, you know, writing for their school newspaper, playing the piano since they were three, you know, getting involved in community organizations, doing drama, you know, as a hobby, you know, so there, it really can be quite varied. And I think the benefit of the ABS is it gives us a bigger picture of who you are. It's not just you as a student preparing for medicine, it's you and your life. All right, we'll give it a minute for any final kind of questions to come in, and I think we'll wrap it up after that. Again, apologies for the low quality video in terms of it may not look or sound quite as polished as we try to get it to. But this is Facebook Live, and you know, we're going at it in a more casual way. This video will be posted on our Facebook page, so you can rewatch it if you missed any part of the session, or if you just want to go back and review. And if you do have questions after we close off, feel free to type them again, and we'll respond. Typically, Alex will kind of follow up after Facebook Live, or myself will log in and we'll answer those questions. And you can, of course, always give us a call or send an email. We are at our peak sort of admissions time. So again, we're getting lots of emails, lots of calls, lots of walk-ins. So we are really working hard to kind of keep to a 48-hour or so turnaround time on email. But if you have an urgent question, don't hesitate to call us. We always have someone to answer the phone, and sometimes that's a better way to get you know, a quick response to your inquiry.
Okay.
All right, I think
so,
we're done.
Yeah, seeing that there's no other questions at the moment, I guess that wraps up our Facebook Live for today. Once again, if you have any questions, feel free to, you know, come in person, send us an email, or give us a call. This video will be posted on Facebook and also on our YouTube channel as well. Approximately maybe about, you know, 15 minutes or so after we conclude this video.
Great, thanks so much for joining us.
Thanks.
Bye.